Thank you. Good morning, all. Thank you for the invitation from Rosa Luxemburg. Just a very minor correction. I didn't work with the Minister of Finance, but with the Minister of Economy. I was his energy advisor in the previous socialist government. Like Fabian was saying, regarding the model in Germany, in Portugal it's quite similar. We've gone for feed-in tariffs. The manager of the transmission grid also has to give priority to renewables. I'll go back a little bit. I will not speak about the politics in Europe, not all that. We'll leave that to discussion. But in terms of renewables, Portugal had quite an important share of renewable electricity in the system since last century because of large hydro. So we had something between 20-30% of renewables in the electricity system. What was done in Portugal between 2000 and 3-4 years ago, sorry, 2 years ago when the right-wing government in power right now won elections, was a very bold commitment to renewable energy, but a commitment that would not just import technology, but would rather develop an industrial cluster in Portugal. This strategy allowed that in 2010, Portugal had 52.7% of total electricity consumption provided by local renewable energy sources. This is mostly wind and hydro. There was a very, very big development on wind. There was a call for 1,700 megawatts in 2006. It was a competitive bidding process. Consortiums that were applying for this, they were required to develop an industrial cluster in the country with jobs, with know-how transfer, developing prediction models, building transformation centers to connect to the grid. This wind cluster now employs 7,000 people. It's based around Enercon, the German turbine maker. But that's the turbine factory for Enercon. Around that, you have 30 factories that employ a further 5,000 people. The integration, it's now 95%. So it means 95% of the added value, it's in Portugal. Portuguese workers, Portuguese factories, lots of know-how transferred. We have developed very sophisticated prediction models for wind energy, 90% accuracy over 3 days. We have minimized variation losses. Portugal has invested in smart grids. We have a project in Évora with a city next to Lisbon with 50,000 smart meters. We've developed the first national electric mobility pilot network. So you can go around Portugal with a car. I will slow down. But the point is, it's possible in only a few years to develop an industrial cluster to improve a lot your energy, your electricity mix, then I will relate to energy, and you can do this at an affordable cost. The tariff, the feed-in tariff we are paying right now for this call that was made in 2005-2006, it's 70 euros per megawatt on wind energy, which is definitely very low among European feed-in tariffs. Obviously, we had something like 100-120 in the past for previous calls, but right now it's 70 euros per megawatt, and what gives back to the country in terms of jobs, taxes, exports, degrees in imports, I think it's quite a good example. What's not a good example in Portugal? Solar. The socialist government, when it came to power in 2005, made renewables a political flag. And in order to put Portugal on the map, they decided to create some of the largest solar parks in the world. Actually, Portugal built the largest solar park in the world back in 2006, 2007. It didn't develop the economy. It's basically imports. It's a centralized, large-scale facility that had 46 megawatts. And instead of doing decentralized, small micro-generation across the country, that was not the policy. We are now fostering also hydro, small hydro and large hydro to improve the unused potential of Portugal in hydro energy. And I'd like to go now to another theme But just to put this in perspective, electricity in Portugal is 22-23% of total energy. So although there is a big progress in terms of renewable electricity, it was 52.7, normally it's between 40% and 50%. In the global energy scene, it's very bad, the dependency. We've managed to decrease dependency from 85% to 75%, and this is mostly imported oil and some coal and gas for the electricity production. What is something that we had to fight off in the last couple of years? When the new government came into power, basically they wanted to kill the political flag of the previous government, and they made the case that electricity in Portugal was expensive and that renewables were to blame. Two lies. First of all, electricity in Portugal, now it was not in the time expensive. It was below the European average. It was below Spain in all the levels of domestic and industrial consumers, except one in industrial consumers. But right now, with the increase in taxes, because the VAT on energy was 6%, it has moved to 23%. Actually, Portugal is above the European average. This was something made to attack the renewable sector. And in the meantime, we had a powerful nuclear lobby we don't have nuclear in Portugal, that was trying to come in the system. We don't need nuclear, obviously, for all the reasons, but even if you forget environmental and social reasons, we just focus on economic reasons and technical efficiency, it doesn't make any sense. We have excess installed capacity now because of the crisis, consumption went down 10%, very much like in Greece, I think 12%. But they are always there, they are always pressuring, and they had the nerve to say that Fukushima proved nuclear was safe because you need an earthquake and a tsunami to make it fail. So that was the point. And these guys, although they are bastards and idiots, they get lots of media attention. They go to the television all the time. If you lower your guard for 1 hour, they are there. So that's another point. Like Fabian was saying, in terms of Germany, energy efficiency should be definitely, and we didn't saw it in the program that much, should be the priority of any government. Portugal has done little on that. We've created the National Energy Efficiency Plan. I have developed the National Efficiency Plan for public administration, but in terms of enforcement, it has not been seriously enforced. Although we have agreed for electric cars, we don't have electric cars because people don't have the money. That also has to do with the model that I criticized a little in the previous government where I worked. Big emphasis on technology, and not on behavioral change. What you need, if you look at the Portuguese case, is to transform the mobility model because it's based on imported cars and imported fuels. You don't need more mobility, you need better accessibility in urban environments, and you can achieve that by walking and cycling. And you don't, and this doesn't have to be too optimistic. The majority of traveling in cities is always below 30 kilometers. That's perfectly achievable with light electric vehicles. That's something that Portugal can make. We make bicycles, we have electric mobility, we can import batteries and motors, assemble locally, and develop light electric vehicles and shared bicycle systems. It's on the rise now. It's a project for some municipalities, and I think it will take off in the next years. Very quickly, privatization of the energy utility and of the grid operator. This was probably the biggest mistake we've done. It was done by this right-wing government now in power. The privatization of the energy utility, it was predicted and it was going to happen anyway. The privatization of the national grid operator was a tragic mistake. I think Greece should not follow on that path. I don't know if that's definitely on the agenda by Troika and government imposing those kinds of changes. The ironic thing is that Portugal developed all this know-how on renewables and on how to integrate renewables in the grid. This year, in the first trimester, we had several days with more than 90% of total electricity consumption provided by renewable energy. Wind alone was responsible for more than 50%. Very quickly, the point being, we developed all this know-how. We sold this to the Chinese. We sold the grid operator and we sold the energy utility to the Chinese. This is even a violation of European law, because you are not unbundling. We did unbundling, now we got this together under different Chinese companies, but that effectively represent the Chinese state. So that's the focus. Some ideas for grids very quickly. It's possible to integrate large amounts of energy on the electricity grid. It's possible to develop a state-of-the-art industrial cluster around renewables in little time within an affordable price, and this is changing your energy model towards sustainability and making possible the introduction of electric mobility in the near future. The pace of technological advances in renewable smart grids energy efficiency mean that autonomous energy systems that might be interesting for islands are possible. Transportation, I was saying, basic thing, I will say, try to avoid by all means the tragic mistake of selling your grid operator. That's the crime. Okay, thank you.